Can everyone hear me? Okay, cool. Okay, so today I'm going to talk to you about block formatting context. So this is a bit of a secret technique that not a lot of people seem to know about. So I just want to talk to you guys about how we use this in the OOCSS open source project. Okay, so just a show of hands, who knows what block formatting context is? Great. Oh, one. Okay, great. The rest of you, focus on me. So this is what's written in the spec about it. So I'm just going to read a little bit out to you guys. Floats, absolutely position elements, block containers, such as inline blocks, table cells, and table captions that are not block boxes, etc., etc. So I can already see a few of you looking a little bit like that. Trust me, and I totally was looking like that when I first read it, because it's just really confusing. So I just want to explain to you in a bit of simple human terms. So block formatting context is basically an element that has a new behavior and is triggered by some CSS properties. So it can be triggered by float left or right, or overflow hidden, display table cell, or position absolute or fixed. So you're probably wondering, what has this got to do with anything, and why is this actually important, and what's useful about it? So it's actually useful for a few things, but tonight I'm just gonna go focus on the one thing. So when we give a new block formatting context to an element, it changes how the block interacts with the floater elements around it. And this is what's written in the spec about it. I'm not gonna be bothered reading it out because it's really confusing and you're not gonna understand what it means. And trust me, it took me a long time to really understand it. So again, in just more simple terms, when you give a block formatting context to an element, it makes the block not wrap around the floater elements, and it also just forces the block to be more narrow. So tonight I'm going to show you a few examples of how we use this technique in an OOCSS open source project. So here we have an example of a gray box that's floated to the left, and then we have a bit of text in a box of yellow border on the right, and there's no float or whatsoever applied to it. So as you can see, the text is actually wrapping around the gray box. So what if we want the text to not wrap around the gray box? What should we do? It's actually quite simple. If you just give it a display table cell on the yellow box, which is one of the CSS properties that triggers block formatting context, then what it does is that it just forces the box to take up the empty space next to the floater element and make it not wrap around the gray box. One thing we have to remember, though, is that if you use display table cell as the CSS property for that, you have to give it a really wide width, because otherwise the box would just shrink wrap to the width of the text. So this is what we call a media block in OOCSS. It's quite a commonly used pattern in, I would say, 90% of the site. Usually it's just an image on the left and then you've got some text on the right. So yeah, it's very, very handy. So I've got a link to the actual code there if you guys want to have a look at it later on. So the other thing we use it for is actually for the grid, on the last column of the grid, more specifically. So browsers have a different way of dealing with how percentage rounds to pixels. So some browsers want round it up, some browsers want it down. So imagine you have a page that is 1,000 pixel wide, and then you've got a three column layout. Each column works out to be about 333.3 pixel. So if you actually round, you've got a browser that rounds up, then the total width will be greater than 1,000 pixel, and your last column will just get pushed down. So if you apply a block formatting context to the last column, it would just know to take up the empty space next to your floated columns, and you avoid this rounding issue. So rounding issue isn't so much a problem these days in modern browsers, but in IE7 it is a problem. So if you have to support all the browsers, or even worse, IE6, then this is a good thing to remember. So the last example I'm going to show you is that we use this when we create templates. So most sites, you will have a page with a left-hand side column, and you've got a main content area on the right. So if we use the same technique on the main content area, what it does is the same thing. It just pushes out the box and let it take up the remaining space next to the side column. So this is actually really handy, because if you ever need to change the width of your side column, then you can just change it and the main content area will know to just grow and shrink, and you don't have to worry about, you know, how wide it should be. The same thing works in the three column page layout. The only downside to this technique is that in your HTML, you actually need to specify your left-hand side column first, and then your right-hand side column, and then your main content area. So if a user is tabbing from top to bottom, then your tab order will be a bit strange, because it will go from left column to right column and then to your main content area. So this is a little bit of a compromise, and it's a bit of a downside, but I guess one thing we can do to help make this less of a problem is by adding ARIA landmark rows, and also having skip links, so that keyboard users or screen reader users can use these things to jump around to the different sections on the page. And that's it. So I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope you'll be able to use this technique in your next build. Thank you very much.